Today, we're kicking off an interview series called Good Conversations, where we will share interesting stories and expert insights to help you arrive, excel, and thrive in Canada. Today, we're going to talk to Smile, a remarkable professional who came here from India all alone and within just a few years has built a successful career in product management, working for one of the world's largest financial technology companies. Smile and I were co-workers a few years ago, and his immigration story is fascinating to me because he's arrived alone to Canada and has deployed a methodological, systematic, and patient approach to his assimilation journey. And fast forward to today, he's built the life that many immigrants dream of when they think of coming to Canada. In this video, Smile will tell us how to feel like home after 1 week of arriving to Canada, and how to find a job and get several job offers within the first couple of months. And lastly, he will share one thing that he finds the most special about this country. Let's tune in. So you just got your citizenship. Congratulations on officially becoming Canadian.
Thank you.
How does it feel?
When I got a mail of getting a citizenship, it didn't feel much because, I mean, the delta between PR and citizenship was like really not that much. So during the event, I think that the feeling sank in. Also, maybe I think you listen to people's reaction and you realize it is kind of a big deal.
So as it sunk in during the ceremony, can you talk a little bit about what actually happened?
3 to 5 years or whatever the time frame is the right amount of time to give someone a citizenship? It takes someone about that much time to connect to the new place. And you don't want to give a citizenship to someone without them having kind of appreciate it or connect it. The whole process, the whole citizenship ceremony is designed in a way, right? Like you have to take an oath in ceremony and you have to sing the national anthem and then you also see other people. A lot of people have come from difficult circumstances. It's a big deal for a lot of people and you see it and you see their reaction and the emotions, and that kind of rubs off you, I think, a little bit.
I remember in my citizenship ceremony, I cried a little, especially when they were saying, like, now you're becoming part of the society, and there's a bunch of motivational things that they're telling you. I was starting to cry a little bit.
Yeah.
It definitely does make you emotional.
I distinctly remember, I think one thing which is unexpected came out of nowhere, but I think when they ended, they said, like, you know, welcome home.
So when they say welcome home, did you feel like you are home?
Oh yeah, I did. It's interesting because I ever felt like I was always home. I think in like week one, I got a feeling that I'm home. So I was super comfortable, like very early on. A lot of it, I think, is also like more mental process and then, you know, then how you kind of feel it. So I think I always had a mindset of it's your decision. No one's forcing this decision on you. And then when you go, you accept it. And you accept everything which comes with it. So I was super comfortable from even week one and just always felt like this is home because that's what it is.
There are sometimes people who can't even feel home after 10 years. When did you know that you wanted to move to Canada, that you wanted a life different than the one that you had back home?
I think it was an intuitive decision to begin with, and then it was much more analytical decision. So the intuitive part of that decision was there is so much more to see, there is so many more cultures to learn, there's so many more people to meet, and there's so much more to do. In my mindset, I always like a citizen of the world. The analytical part of that was which country to move to. And that's where I had like a list of 5 countries that I could move to. And then I selected one which I think would made the most sense. So that part was like more calculated, and that was based on professional goals and based on a lot of other things like culture.
Did you travel a lot when you were growing up? Because when you say that you felt like you were a citizen of the world, I'm curious to know, how did you come to feel that you're a citizen of the world?
Even if you are living in different countries, you're consuming the similar kind of a stuff. You're consuming the same media. You're listening to the similar news. You listen to the same bands. Like, you know, your music tastes are different. You watch this similar movies on Netflix. As a society, we have transcended the boundaries of a country in terms of our societal and our cultural heritage. So we connect to a lot of things which are common to a lot of people across the world. I know, for instance, when I was growing up, my favorite bands were the rock bands, like the Seattle Sound, and Nirvana, and like Pearl Jam. They're all based in US. And I was consuming them like thousands of kilometers away. But I felt like a deep connect with the music they were creating. Another example for this would be like, I think the people of the world connected with what's happening in Ukraine, right? People are not like, we're not in Ukraine, but we still connected with what's happening. And that's happening because I think the world is coming together in the cultural aspect of it. I think that transition is just happening because of technology, because of YouTube.
I think that's a very good example of how music and art connects people around the world. Feeling that connection through the things that you value, you appreciate, and that you like, and feeling like you're connected to something or someone who's thousands of miles away, I think is a powerful feeling to have. And to your point about Ukraine as well, right? We all feel connected because we realize that we value one same thing. We value freedom of choice, we value freedom, we value peace, and that's what kind of connects us together.
John Lennon has been like one of my favorite persons that I'm influenced. Maybe when he was mentioning, imagine there are no countries, it was not the actual meaning of not imagining the borders, but it was, and I think maybe we are all almost there, like, you know, we imagine as if there are no countries just because of how much the technology and the world has changed. We still have borders and all of that stuff, but to some extent, they have disappeared, or the lines have blurred a little bit.
Mm-hmm. And I guess it goes the other way around. You being away from home, you still have some of your family back in India. You probably have some of your friends there. You're not that disconnected from them either, because the internet is what allows you to keep connected and stay in touch.
That definitely is true, because I do think about the people who made like similar decisions in 16th, 17th century, like when French came to Canada or British came to Canada. It would have been much harder because you're going to a new land you don't really know. You don't know the culture to expect. You don't know what you're going to expect. No media. There was no news to read about. And I think that decision was very different from the decisions that you and me are making now. Technology has made a lot of these things easier. We know what to expect when we go to a new place.
So talking about knowing or learning what to expect, you felt like you were home within the first week. One big part of that was mindset. But what are some of the other things that you've done before your move or kind of thought about that you think helped you feel more like it's home?
To be honest, mindset was like 80% of it. No place is perfect. No culture is perfect. It's just what side of the coin you want to look at. So you can always look at a new place and you can always see the things which are not perfect, right? Like even in Canada, there are things which are not great, and we all know it. There's so much things which are amazing, and you have to just focus on that. When you start with the perspective of looking at the right things, everything else is just falls into place. To some extent, like when I was comparing countries, I was sort of looking at pros and cons list, like I think everyone else does. But I was always trying to maximize the upside rather than trying to like minimize the downside. Because there would always be a downside. There would always be, you know, in any culture, there would be, or in any country, for instance, there would be things that could dishearten you. All you have is a perceptional understanding of a new place. Because all the media that you consume, it gives you information, but it also comes from a lens of bias. So you have to be a little bit neutral. You don't make the right decision, or you don't aspire to make the right decision, but I'm gonna make a decision, and then I'm gonna make it right.
So talking to a former colleague of mine, and he has a background in military, and I asked him, like, what's that one thing from military that's taught you that you still apply in business today?
Yeah.
And then he gave me this quote that a bad decision is better than no decision.
Yeah.
And I think it's very similar to what you're talking about, where if you make a bad decision, you can learn from it quickly, you see the results of it, and then you can adjust your approach and make it right. But if you don't make a decision at all, you just continue contemplating and stressing.
I really like that, because I think the ancient or the medieval world was based on lack of information. But I think in the modern world, the challenge is excess of information. With internet especially, there would always be more information, there would always be more data, but then that leads to like a decision paralysis, because then you're just consuming information, but you're not acting. And there's like a sweet spot wherein you know enough to take an action with a limited amount of knowledge, and that's a constraint. This is good enough for me, and I'll figure it out after I make a decision.
And I think the important component of that is having the confidence that you will make that right decision, or that you will figure it out no matter what.
Yeah, well. And that's I think why I said like mindset was like 80% of things. Having optionality is also a privilege. I was coming from a place where I had an option to go back, but not everyone has that. What if I was coming from a country, and what if I was coming from a circumstances where I couldn't go back? Would I not make a decision right after taking it? The answer was yes, and then maybe I'll just make it right anyway.
So what was the 20%?
I think 80% the mindset, and 20% was just being aware. There was an analytical process of identifying 5 countries to move to and filtering 5 countries on some criteria, being aware of what's happening around you and what you want.
So when you said you were building this list of 5 countries, Can you highlight some of the criteria that you used for decision making, and where did Canada stand out?
There's a lot of things going for Canada, actually. So the professional opportunities, I knew I would always go to a place which has more opportunities in software. I was certain that this is what I'm going to do for the rest of my life. And the second was essentially a country where you could converse in English, or the English is still the primary language. So Germany, for instance, was another interesting country I was looking at. In Berlin, you can still be an English-speaking person, but you would never be able to connect with the culture till the time you learn German. Basically, for Canada, like, you don't have to learn a new language if you're not in Quebec. It has a great IT software industry, which is what I wanted to work in. It was fairly close to the States. A lot of opportunities being in the same time zone, being in the same continent as the US. The other factors were, like, pretty similar, I would say, in the remaining countries. Cultural and political alignment, this probably is not as well considered. But I also wanted to move to a country where I would relate to the culture or the political environment. And that's, I think, is important, especially if you're looking at a long-term decision. You don't want to just come to a country wherein you have opportunities, you earn well, and all of that stuff. But you also want to come to a country where you can assimilate with the culture and you are aligned with the cultural values of a new country.
What components of Canadian culture, apart from multiculturalism, that resonated with you the most?
I think I share the values of freedom of speech, for instance. It's interesting, there's a lot of things that Western world takes for granted is not something fairly consistent across the world. Freedom of speech just seems like fairly common in US and Canada and the Western world, but it's not in a lot of other countries, apart from obviously the other things, which is like an open culture and multiculturalism, which is very rare, I think. Not many countries can claim to be as open and as culturally acceptable.
Can you still talk about that first week or maybe first month after you moved to Canada? Was there something that surprised you, that something that you didn't expect?
Nothing shocking at all. I don't think I was super surprised or by anything, to be honest. I mean, there's like new things that you figure it out every day, but we would figure it out anyway. Like if I go to like any other state in India, I would find the similar subtle things which you don't know because you're not in that place. And it's not just like a different country. If you go to like a different city, you would find different things that you didn't know and you go, oh, fine, okay, I know how this works now. One thing eventually I realized was how different Canadian and the culture in the US was.
What are those differences?
It's not one big thing, it's like a lot of small things. Mm-hmm. Canada just seems to be like being a lot more, I wouldn't say welfare state, but to some extent a welfare state. And then there's other subtle things like the political polarization. American culture is just more focused on productivity.
So talking about productivity, what did your first couple of months look like? Can you talk a bit about how you approached your job search?
I did the groundwork, I think, mostly myself and by reading. And like, I think there were like three things that I was doing in parallel. One is cold applying on the company's website, career pages, and LinkedIn. Second is going via the recruiter route. And the third one was essentially trying to know people and seek referrals. I spent my time equally experimenting with all of these three techniques and see what works and iterating from that.
So how did you iterate and what ended up landing your first job in Canada?
So I broke down this problem and I kept a log of how much time I'm spending. So, and what is the hit rate of getting an interview? So if I'm applying at 10 places on their website, how many are giving me an interview call? From there, you can create like a pattern of like, you know, what is the hit rate of this method A, versus you're talking to 10 recruiters, how many of them gave you interesting opportunities or in companies within a week. And third is how much time you spend talking to like these people and trying to seek referrals. So from there, you can get a sense of which of these approaches is working fine for you and for the company and for the type of work that you're looking for. And once you realize this is working fine, you just double down on that.
Very analytical and thoughtful and thorough approach as well. And I think the key thing that I pick up here is experimenting and trying everything.
You have to figure it out what works in this environment. And then over a period of time, it becomes obvious. Getting the first job is where you have to like understand a little bit more. Mm-hmm. But once you are in there, and then subsequent transitions becomes much more easier.
So which one of the three ways landed your first job?
I got two job offers within the same week. So one came via the recruiter and one came via referral. The cold calling didn't work as much, like in the cold applying. But for my situation, what worked initially was a recruiter, reaching out to a recruiter, and then getting a referral.
How much time did it take for you between the time you started looking for a job, between you accepting the offer?
I would say 2 months. Also because there was like a bunch of interview rounds, yeah. Especially in software, you're like 4 or 5 interview rounds, and then the interview process takes time. I mean, it generally could take from like, you know, 1 month to 4 or 5 months.
Were you prepared to or considering doing a survival job?
No, I think initially I just knew that what I wanted to do, and I was just super focused on that. Because you don't spend too much time on the survival job, that becomes your new base reality. And if you spend like 8 hours a day, then you just didn't really keep enough time for yourself to focus on what you really want to do. And then, you know, it's not aligned with what you want to do. So there's a risk to a survival job. It might increase the amount of time that you find the right fit of right kind of a job that you're looking for. On the other hand, if there are some other constraints that you have, and then maybe survival job could be considered, but then you have to time box it. So maybe one way is do a survival job, but maybe only on weekends, or maybe not more than 3 days a week. Because you want to keep the good chunk of amount of time for yourself to focus on finding the job that you want to do. And also you want to feel a little bit of a pain of not finding it, because that would increase your desire to find it sooner. Because if you get comfortable using a survival job, it reduces your hunger to find the right job for you.
I think it speaks a little bit to just the general motivation or the reason why do you want to move to Canada in the first place. Immigrants want to move to Canada so much, and that's their whole entire goal in life, that once they move to Canada, suddenly they don't have a goal anymore. They've achieved the only thing that they've strived for, and now they're just kind of existing, complacent on the survival job.
Yeah, I think there's a concept of finite games versus infinite games. The finite game is when you start with an objective in mind, and then once you meet an objective, that's an end of it. Infinite game is that it doesn't have a fixed end. Playing the game because you want to play the game. Keep increasing the complexity, and I'm just saying a reference of a game, but this is true for, I think, life in general. Because if you start with a fixed end in mind, then you would probably stop sooner, or maybe as soon as you achieve that particular thing. If you like a game that you're playing, why would you want it to end? And if you always wanted the game to end, why are you playing it? Because you're probably not enjoying it, you're just waiting for the end to come sooner.
So we've talked a little bit about your initial journey, and we've talked a little bit about the job search, which is oftentimes one of the main concerns, one of the main priorities for someone moving to Canada, because you need to start making these Canadian dollars. Looking at the pyramid of Maslow, once you have those basic needs met of safety, you having a roof under your head, the next big step is your kind of social circle. How hard or easy was it for you to start making friends?
I met most of the people from work. I came for work, so I think that's where I would find most of the people. The other set of friends that I have is other friends who after me migrated from India. The challenge was a little bit more during COVID. The only place that you would meet people is work. Post-COVID or during COVID when you're doing like these work from home jobs, I think that reduces your social connect a little bit, because I mean, you're just meeting people virtually now. I know a lot of people who came after or during COVID, and it was much harder for them.
Do you feel like now it's coming back to normal and now there's more ways for you to socialize and meet people?
The last 6 months is like because the COVID restrictions have lifted, and I think this summer was much better than previous summer. Social activities are coming back again, so you can still meet people.
And then how's your experience in Toronto been so far?
I love Toronto. I think it's just like when you come here and you spend so much time, so you know the city pretty well. All of your friends are, you know, like all of my friends are in and around Toronto mostly. I went to Quebec, Montreal, and it was just so beautiful. And I was like, I should move to Montreal. But then if you compare it holistically on the, you know, the pros and cons, I would still prefer Toronto to any other place in Canada, just because of the opportunities that I have as a software professional. Also, like other things, like there's some sort of social network that you have developed living here over time.
So one thing that you've mentioned when you were chatting right before is, in retrospect, if you were to be building the list of those 5 countries to move to today, you might not have chosen Canada.
Every decision is made in a certain time and with a certain amount of knowledge. You probably don't want to hear someone else's decision and try to replicate it. Decisions are super personal. You want to look at the decision-making framework and see how those decisions were made and try to customize the decision-making framework for yourself.
So coming back to your very first job in Canada, tell us a little bit about your general impression about the culture, about the work itself. How different was it from your experience back in India?
I think the main thing that the first year or so that I was learning was mostly about cultural. In India, most of the work that I've done was within startups. Similar field, but much different circumstances because it's startups, smaller teams, and all of more ownership. And during my first job, the learning was essentially understanding the culture, trying to figure it out. The first year was mostly just trying to understand how the system operates, just trying to learn the culture, just trying to learn more about people. The easier part was just trying to do your job, which I think was easier because I had done that work before.
You've mentioned that once you get your foot in the door, once you get your first job, it gets a lot easier going forward.
I think I like to think it in like frameworks. So one of the frameworks that I use is the iPhone launches. Create a brand new iPhone 14, and then next year you create like a 14S, which is an optimization of iPhone 14. In 1 year, you make a super big decision, and then the next year is essentially optimizing the decision. The next year and the next opportunities is just trying to optimize it. Slightly better product, slightly better opportunity.
And did you feel like it was a lot easier to be getting your optimization jobs after you've had some Canadian experience?
Much easier. And I think because of the network, because you know people who can introduce you to new roles. And also you're coming from one role to another, so you can take your time. So I waited till I find the better opportunity. And if I don't find that better opportunity, I wouldn't move. So you always have a baseline, and then you're looking for better work.
And looking back in the last 3 to 4 years, what lessons did Canada teach you?
I think maybe one thing was that we share more with people than we even think we share. At some level, different people born at different times in different countries and grown up in different cultures, there's still very similar threads that you can find. Humanity is more intertwined than it appears to be. Because till the time you meet a lot of people from a lot of different places, you don't see that manifest. You don't see that you could be so similar in some aspects. But once you are, especially in Canada, because you get a lot of opportunity to talk to people from different areas and different countries, there's a lot more intersection. It's a lot more common within people than it appears to be. Our motivations, our fears, aspirations, thinking patterns. It's different how people focus a lot more on the things which are different rather than focusing on a lot of things which are common. Because there are a lot more things in common than there's like things that are different. Because we choose to see the differences more than the commonalities. And I think if you see the commonalities first, it would just flip the way we engage with each other. I don't think there would be as many wars.
I think it has something to do with our ancestors and how we've developed and evolved over the thousands of years. People used to live in small communities or small tribes, and then they were used to each other, so they knew each other. And then the moment they encounter someone who's different, who they've never met before, suddenly and automatically, that one is an enemy. They're an outsider. Maybe that's just ingrained into who we are as humans. We naturally and instinctively look at differences as a mean to protect ourselves.
Probably it's true too. It's like a lot of survival instinct is baked into that. But also, if you look at people with a shared culture, they still see themselves as different. And I think a lot of that is essentially one way to unite a people is to disengage them from other people. A lot of the countries, their existence is hinged on an existence of another country and how they are different from that country. You hate another country, another culture so much, but that is exactly the culture which is shaping you and giving you an identity of who you are. To give an example, like Cold War, for instance, has two sides, Soviet side and there's American side. If you remove one of the sides, there is no Cold War, but you have to have a two polar thinking directions, or you have to have two different polars to rally people around.
On this topic of connectedness and us being all similar, and one of the things that you've highlighted before is the multiculturalism. How does that stand in practice? Looking at your circle of friends, looking at the dynamic at work, do you feel like that Canada really embodies that multiculturalism? Do you think it's easy to make friends with people that are different than you in Canada?
I do think so, because my experience has been extremely good on that front. It's been super easy for me to talk and make friends with different people. But I'm also cognizant of the fact that someone else has a different experience, and now it's our opportunity to kind of reach out and reduce the difference, especially like the indigenous people. They've not felt the love of multiculturalism because of like historic reasons and because of what has happened in the past.
I also know that you've traveled a little bit. You've seen some other provinces too. Is there something you've been meaning to do but haven't done yet?
Yeah, I think Canada has a lot more to see than I have seen. I would love to go to Atlantic provinces. I also have like a some time I want to do like a road trip from the East Coast to the West Coast. Oh, one other thing that I would love to do is explore the North. I think that's fascinating. It's so unique and we're just so close.
And then when you think about traveling within Canada and around the world, how do you prioritize and make decisions?
I generally have a thing that I would eventually end up seeing a lot of the states because of my work. I would focus more on my personal trips to be more focused in Canada.
When you hear the word Canadian culture, what comes to your mind?
Multiculturalism, being kind.
Favorite Canadian food?
Oh, Eggs Benedict? I don't know. Is it
Canadian?
Is it Canadian? I was going to say poutine, but then I thought like it'd just be cliche.
Is there something that you started doing in Canada that you haven't had a habit of in India?
I've always taken walks, so that's a non-answer. A lot more cooking, I would say. Yeah, maybe biking a little bit more.
How's winter for you in Canada?
I like it. I love winters. I don't think I would like to be in a place where there's no snow. It's fine if the place has like less snow. I mean, Toronto gets like 3 months of snow, so it's fine if you have like 1 month of snow. And I like the tranquility which comes when it snows. I would prefer snow than rain. The snow would get the brownie points.
I like that. Is there something that you can't get used to in Canada? Like, for instance, one thing I still can't get used to is that most places or stores close early. Some of them close at 5 or 6 p.m. I still can't get used to it.
There's some aspects when I look at technology, I think like you could do it better. Banking, for instance. There's still a lot of things where like, you know, you have to do a wire transfer, you have to write a check. Can you just do cell phone transfer sort of things?
Yeah.
Mostly because I work in technology, so when I look at technology, I'm in a debug mode, and I was like, and you could do it better because I've seen better instances or better technology applied somewhere else in a similar situation.
Coming back to the technology question, it's actually a common complaint among a lot of Asian or European immigrants, how outdated banking system is, the healthcare system, and a lot of those systems, even telecom, thinking about the internet speeds and the prices that we pay and things like that. So you might think that Canada might be one of the first world countries, one of the richest and best economies in the world, but still some of the technological aspects, it's lagging behind big time.
And maybe the other thing that jumps out is centralization. More decentralization might be more beneficial. The grocery stores are all the same. Food joints or the food chains, they're all the same. Which basically means more standardization, but also lack of diverse options. I see why centralization is efficient, and that's why it has kind of flourished. But I think there's a place in the world wherein, you know, you also want to promote like more local stuff. Convenience stores owned by family-owned businesses and things like that.
It's interesting that we've just talked about multiculturalism and how diverse Canada is, and then we're talking about how everything is being centralized and standardized, which is the opposite of being diverse and multicultural sometimes. What do you want for Canadians to stop doing?
Like, there's a dichotomy of being honest and being politically correct, and sometimes I think honesty is veiled by being political correctness. I also don't want to say it like everyone does it and just paint it like, you know, this is the Canadian culture, because that's a very risky thing to do. I mean, we could be more upfront. We could say when we don't like something, or we could be more honest about how we are thinking or what our viewpoints are.
And then my next question was going to be, what do you want for Canadians to start doing?
We have to be cognizant of the fact that opportunity is equally distributed within Canada. A lot of jobs and opportunities is distributed between like three main cities, which means like there's a lot of people who have no option but to be in that particular area, which causes a lot of other challenges. So I think trying to be cognizant of the fact opportunity is more equally distributed probably would go a long way. US has so many mid-sized cities, and then they have like a huge cities like New York and San Francisco. Canada has a lot of big cities like Toronto, Vancouver, Montreal. But then, to some extent, the mid-sized city layer is missing, where people can move to without compromising on the opportunity. So the options in that sense are fairly limited.
I guess in some way, things are getting a little bit more distributed now with the remote work, and opportunities are becoming a little bit more equal.
I think definitely the situation is, I would say, slightly better than it was pre-COVID. But then there's again like a large places of where the opportunity has not knocked yet. If you move there, you know that you are compromising on opportunity or quality of life.
Where do you think Canada could improve?
Creating a system which supports, if Canada knows that X amount of citizens, or X amount of immigrants are going to come to Canada. You need to have an ample infrastructure to support them. There is a balance between, let's say, supply and demand. So pre-planning in terms of, because you all already know how much the population growth is going to be, for instance, or where that would be distributed. So improving on the systems like public transport, housing, and things like that to be better prepared so that when people come in, they're not struggling on finding or compromising on the basic things. Very predictable. If you already have a planned numbers, plan stuff pretty easily, and it's just sort of strange that no one is doing it as much.
It's been 4 years for you in Canada. You're a citizen now. You've got that blue passport. You are now working at an amazing world-class organization as well. What's next for you?
I really like being in Canada. Pretty happy with what Toronto offers. Once you have a citizenship, also comes with responsibilities. Also gives you more opportunities to like assimilate and kind of understand the culture. And now you're at a unique position where you don't get to complain. You get to change. That is where kind of I want to focus my energies on and how to make this place even better.
To zoom in onto your you don't get to complain, you can actually do something. I know you recently signed up to work for Toronto elections.
I'm trying to do like one new thing every day, even if it is a small thing. I think it just keeps you push the edges of your comfort level a little bit, makes you acquainted with the things that you don't necessarily get to do. But also, to some extent, it is like understand the system, understand the political system and vote for it, but also facilitate other people exercise their voting rights.
If only more people thought like this, what kind of advice would you give to someone thinking about moving to Canada? And we talked a lot about the mindset, how to approach making a decision.
I think first of all, it's going to be a very personal decision for everyone. Canada, and I think for that matter, any other country, it's not like one size fits all. It's not like this is the best country and everyone should leave their respective countries and move here. So I think everyone has to decide it for themselves. Is this is what they're looking for? Is the framework here, is the type one decision or the decisions which are hard to reverse? Opportunity cost is like 5 to 10 years of your time. So I think one of the things that people can do, information gathering is the first part of it. Maybe talk to a few people if you know people in Canada or you watch these videos. And then you have to apply all of the data that you have gathered to your personal situation. And then independently make a decision if you want to migrate and if Canada is the right place for you. I think everyone knows deep down what's right for them. It's equally important to realize the factors for which you might not want to move. Peer pressure, for instance. A decision made because you see other people around you are moving to a new country, and I don't think that is probably the right metric to look at.
That's interesting that you talk about peer pressure. Who should not be moving to Canada?
If you don't find a particular reason of why you should be moving, that's sort of, I think, a red flag. It's not that the life situation drastically changes when you're in Canada. You still have to work. You'll get more opportunities, probably, but so you have to probably do twice as much work just to come to the baseline. So you have to be appreciative of the fact that there's gonna be like a hard work even if you move.
Let's address to someone who's already in Canada. They might be struggling finding a job, making friends, connecting to someone. It's been maybe a couple of years they've been here. What words of advice would you give a person like that?
One of the things that you have to believe is, in the long term, everything is going to be all right. All of your problems are not going to exist in the long term. You'll figure it out. And I think that, again, is most like a mental hack rather than anything else. But I think you have to start with like a positive frame of mind, because it can get overwhelming. Break it down. Break down whatever you want to achieve into smaller bits of things that you can accomplish so that it doesn't look as scary when it's broken down. And then just start working on it. It gets better from there.
How about we play two tiny games? Best Toronto neighborhood.
King West. I'm biased.
Your favorite place in Toronto?
Toronto Islands.
Toronto Islands? Maple Leafs or Toronto Raptors?
Raptors.
Next city in Canada you'd like to visit?
Halifax.
Canadian beer or Indian beer?
Canadian beer. It's just better. There's no bias in there.
Okay. Indian food or Canadian, North American food?
Indian food, I would say.
Is there a bias in there?
It's just better.
It's just better. Indian banks or Canadian banks?
Indian banks for technology, mostly.
Most famous Canadian person to you?
No, I was going to say that lady called Agnes. So she was essentially the first woman who got elected for an office anywhere in the British Empire, 1700s, 1800s. One, but the other one I was thinking is like Terry Fox, maybe. I find him very inspirational.
I would not have expected that answer. Suburbs Toronto or downtown Toronto?
Downtown Toronto.
Mountains or sea?
Both. Slightly biased towards mountains.
French cuisine or British cuisine?
French cuisine any day.
Summer in Toronto or winter in Toronto?
I don't know. I think I like both. Summers are shorter, so you look forward to them. But then when they're winters, I just enjoy the snow too.
So one thing that I think stands out a lot about you is how you make decisions, using frameworks, crafting your mindset to make decisions. Would you recommend some resources or learn a little bit about frameworks on how to make decisions?
I think it's just an application of system designs thinking onto your life. How you break down a project, like as an engineer, use the same things, make decisions in life. And the second thing is like iterating on that. I'm in general super interested in like human psychology. I think I just read like a bunch of books around that and like how humans think. And also some podcasts, like I highly recommend Naval's podcast. He's on Twitter at Naval. So I read about stoicism. I saw how practical it was. Reading more about framework helps. You just have a name to what you're already doing, and then you can just retrofit it, or you can just see how other people are thinking, like learn from that. I do follow a lot of people thinking and like a lot of interviews about how people make decisions. I'm in tech, so maybe I was like listening to Mark Zuckerberg's podcast. What I'm interested in knowing, not what he is doing, what he eats and what time he wakes up, that's immaterial, but what is his framework of making those decisions? How does any person prioritizes and how do they approach getting it done? Listening to other people's perspective, I think helps, but eventually I think you have to customize it based on what works for you. So I've experimented, I think, a fair bit of thing before landed into something which is still work in progress.
And it sounds like the biggest takeaway is just read a lot, do your own research, learn things, and just be curious and be hungry.
I think being curious definitely helps.
And to our earlier conversation about playing the game, is pretty much treated like a game.
It helps because then you disassociate from the result, because then you take a third-person perspective of playing a game.
Thank you, Smile, for this brilliant and insightful conversation.
All right, yeah, thanks. I think this is a fun conversation. I hope some of it was useful.
I've learned a handful of frameworks that I can start applying in my future decisions, no matter whether it's moving somewhere or getting a new job or changing or deciding what you want to do in life. I hope you guys got some interesting insights as well. Please let me know in the comments below which one of the Smile's insights or experiences or thoughts resonated with you the most, or can you relate to that at all? And if you'd like this conversation, how Smile thinks, feel free to follow him on Twitter. We'll leave a link in the description box below. And as always, don't forget to leave a like button if you think that more people should see this video, and make sure to follow us to stay tuned on the future conversations with remarkable individuals like Smile. And we'll see you in the next one.